Donald Trump again joins us, and I've got so many questions. But first off, Donald, thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Alex. Great to be with you.
I've got so many questions, but you are vindicated. This has got to be the 50th time in the last 6 months on the radical Muslims celebrating, not just in New Jersey, but New York, Palestine, all over. What do you have to say? They're still attacking you, though. We've got Dan Rather on video. We've got New York Post. We've got Washington Post. We've got, what's going on here?
Well, I took a lot of heat, and I was very strong on it, and I held my line, and then all of a sudden, you know, hundreds of people were calling up my office. I was the other day in Sarasota, Florida, and people are online, and we had 12,000 people, which is fantastic. And the people were saying, many of the people from New Jersey, four or five people said, Mr. Trump, I saw it myself. I was there. They talked about Patterson, but they said, I saw it myself, Mr. Trump. I was there. So many people have called in, and on Twitter, at Real Donald Trump, they're all tweeting. So I knew it happened, and I held my line, and people wanted me to apologize, and we can't do that. People like you and I can't do that so easily. Now, we can do it if we're wrong, Alex. You apologize. I'd apologize if I was wrong. But they were celebrating, and they were celebrating the fall of the World Trade Center. I think that's disgraceful.
It is. And that same week you were reporting on that fact, we had two different international football games, soccer games, with the Turkish fans and others during the moment of silence for the dead people in Paris, chanting Allah Akbar and booing. So did that not happen too?
Well, that happened and everybody saw it. That was a week ago, and the players were out on the field and they couldn't believe it. They were embarrassed. They didn't know what to do. The coach and the managers, they all apologized, but it happened. Look, we have to deal with reality. And, you know, it all started because I said we need surveillance. We need proper surveillance. We have people that truly are evil. And they're coming from someplace, and you know sort of where they're coming from, at least the vicinity. And I said, we need proper surveillance, whether it's a mosque or any place else. We have to be surveilled, and we have to see what's coming at us, because we're not going to have a country anymore. Between the weak borders that we have, the pathetic and weak borders where politicians are afraid to do anything about it, between all of what's happening with radical, you know, you look at what's going on. You have a president that doesn't even want to talk about, you know, the radical Muslim stuff. He doesn't want to mention the word. He doesn't want to say it. But you look at what's happening where we have a president that's over there celebrating global warming and trying to get everybody excited about global warming. Like, that's our number one problem. He considers that to be our number one problem. And our number one problem is what's going on, where they want to blow up our cities and they want to blow up our country. That's our number one problem.
You said months ago, bomb the oil of ISIS, and the mainstream media laughed because you said the sky was blue again. Now the Pentagon says that's the right thing to do. And now you've come out saying, quote, it looks like that Turkey's on the side of ISIS, close quote. Well, that the next day the Russians released satellite photos documenting that there are literally thousands of trucks coming up to the border at these huge terminals connected to Irgun, the president's son, making billions of dollars total off of this. Again, you're in trouble for saying the sky is blue.
Well, I was right about that. I was right in saying in a book that I wrote, you covered it really nicely, I appreciate it, but I wrote a very political book years ago in the year 2000, The America We Deserve, and I said in that book that we better be careful with this guy named Osama bin Laden. I mean, I really study this stuff. I really find it very interesting, and even though I'm a businessman, I've been involved in politics. I said, we better be careful with Osama bin Laden. There's a guy named Osama bin Laden. Nobody really knew who he was, but he was nasty. He was saying really nasty things about our country and what he wants to do to it. And I wrote in the book, 2000, 2 years before the World Trade Center came down, I talked about Osama bin Laden. You better take him out. I said, he's going to crawl under a rock. You better take him out. And now people are seeing that. They're saying, you know, Trump predicted Osama bin Laden, which actually is true. And then 2 years later, a year and a half later, he knocked down the World Trade Center. And I talked about terrorism and that. That was before terrorism as we know it today. I said, we better be careful. That's going to happen. It's going to be a big thing. And it certainly is a big thing. So with the oil, and I'm glad you brought it up, but as you know, for 3 years, I've been saying you better take out the oil, because if you don't take the oil, it's going to be a problem. So we shouldn't have been in Iraq. But once we got there, the way we came out was horrible. And I said, take the oil. Then we didn't take the oil. So ISIS got the oil. And as you know, Iran is getting the oil, because Iran is going to take over all of Iraq.
The more I research what you've actually said and done, it's amazing. You were the only leading American figure who openly said, do not go to war in Iraq. They had almost, what, 90% votes in Congress for it, bipartisan. You said, don't do it. Iran will take over. Look, you can say that today, and everybody can say that, but you said that in 2001, 2002, 2003, when it was very unpopular because you'd done your research and had good advisors. How did you know that when almost no one else did?
Well, first of all, I'm the most militaristic person there is. I'm going to build the military. If I win, I'm going to make our military so strong, so powerful that nobody's going to mess with us. We're going to take care of our vets and all of that. But I have to tell you, you have to know if you're going to go to war, you have to do it properly and you have to know what to do. I viewed it as this. Iran and Iraq were the same in terms of strength. And they'd constantly fighting. That's all they do is they fight, right? They go to war all the time and they'd move 10 feet left, 10 feet right, 10 feet left, then they'd rest. And then they've started again 4 years later. This has been gone on for forever. And this is the way it is. I said, if you take out Iran or if you take out Iraq, either one, you're going to destabilize the Middle East. Well, we took out Iraq. And by the way, Iraq has the second largest oil reserves in the world. People don't even know that. So we gave, like, incredible. We took out Iraq. I said, you're going to destabilize. Well, and I said, and you'll know this, and you know this, and I appreciate what you just said. Then Iran is going to come in and Iran is going to take over Iraq. And they're just taking it over right now. As we speak, they're taking it over. Iran is running Iraq and very soon will be virtually going to be totally running Iraq, especially after all of, you know, the deal we just made, which is the worst. So I said, keep the oil. And I said, if you're going to leave, you shouldn't have gone in, but they should have left soldiers behind, like 20,000 or a certain number of soldiers. But if you're going to leave, take the oil. And I've said it. Then they left, they didn't take the oil. So ISIS got the oil, Iran is getting the oil, everybody's getting everything but us. So we lost thousands of soldiers. We spent $2 trillion in Iraq. We have wounded warriors who I love all over the place. And what do we get out of it, Alex? We had nothing. We had nothing.
So, no, the French and the Germans are getting the oil and the Iranians are getting the oil.
And you know who the number one customer for the oil is? Guess what? China.
That's right.
How smart is China? They outsmart us on every level militarily. They outsmart us on trade, like, we have a $450 billion trade deficit with China.
Let me ask you this. You're a top business guy, you know, on your own from nothing. How did China get 97% of rare earth minerals in the world? How is the United States or nobody else even trying to get rare earth minerals when it's what goes in the smartphones, the computers, trillions is made a year? How did we just give them the global market in that? That's crazy.
Well, what a lot of people don't know, Afghanistan. Now, Afghanistan's a place we can go in because, you know, you have Pakistan and you have nuclear weapons, a lot of things going on there. But we go into Afghanistan, we're fighting, you know, tremendous mountains and ridges. We're fighting on one side. And you know who's got their excavators on the other side?
China,
taking out all the minerals. You know, Afghanistan, nobody knew this. Afghanistan is rich with minerals, not oil, but minerals.
Lithium, everything.
And China's taking out all the minerals. And here we are fighting. We have trillions. We have like $1 trillion in Afghanistan, and we get nothing out of it. And we're going to end up leaving and keeping a couple of thousand soldiers there and this and that. We get nothing. China is taking out the minerals. They're the buyers, the big buyers at very, very low prices of, as you know, of the oil in Iraq and probably in Syria. But China is a big buyer of the oil. But one thing with the oil, it's sort of because you've covered it. For 3 years, I've been saying hit the oil because ISIS is getting strong and they're no JV, as the president said, and they're certainly not contained. But I said, hit the oil and hit them hard. And they laughed at me and they would put generals on television saying, no, that strategy wouldn't work. Well, after Paris, they started hitting the oil and it does work. The problem is we've given them a 2 year edge. They have billions of dollars.
The Russians started hitting the oil for 1 month and ISIS is already rolling over. Can you speak to, as president, what your relationship would be with foreign leaders and what you know about Vladimir Putin? Because all I know is, why are we starting a fight with Russia when they're not doing anything to us?
Right. Well, number one, and just to finish on the oil, by the way, I say hit the oil, but we should keep the oil. In other words, we should keep. We'll get ExxonMobil. They'll go in. We'll get other of our oil companies. We'll get some of the great oil companies. We bid it out. We should keep the oil. You know, in the old days, to the victor belong the spoils, right? We don't have that. We go in, we fight a war, and we leave. We get nothing, except we get debt and we get deficit. That's all we get. I think I get along great with people. I mean, I will probably get along well with him. And if I don't, somebody else will. And who knows? You know, he's a difficult cookie. He's tough and he's smart. I was on the show 60 Minutes with him recently, not together. I mean, they did him and they profiled me at the same show, which was that we were stable mates, right? But I think I'd get along very well with him. I think it'd do fine. Look, here's the thing. We lose with every country, and yet we don't get along with any countries. China is killing us. Everybody's killing us. China's just beating us to a pulp and trade. Japan, Mexico is killing us. And yet we don't get along with anybody. With me, they're not going to get so rich, believe me.
What about crippled America? It's a number one. You got a big rally tonight. Everywhere you go, your crowds just get bigger. I mean, obviously, you're probably going to get the Republican nomination now. Wow, and you're ready for the dirty tricks. 1 minute left, Donald Trump. What do you have to say about your book and what's coming up?
Well, first of all, before the book, because you mentioned one thing, I had never heard that, but I am in this to win it. I am not in this to say, oh, gee, I've done a really good job. A reporter called up, a very powerful reporter, said, how does it feel? How does it feel? I said, it only feels, because they said what we've done has never been done before politically. And I've been in the poll for 5 months since it came out. I'm number one. I said, it's only good if we win. If I don't win, I've wasted a lot of time. That's the way I view it. He said, no, you haven't. You haven't. I said, believe me, if I don't win. Because we can't do anything to make our country great if I don't win. I'll be watching television someplace. It'll be forget it. So I wrote a book called Crippled America. It's doing fantastic business. I don't know if you can see that thing right up there.
We can.
But it's doing great business. I hope your audience goes out and buys it as Christmas gifts and everything else. And I just want to finish by saying your reputation's amazing. I will not let you down. You will be very, very impressed, I hope. And I think we'll be speaking a lot, but you'll be looking at me in a year, and a year, or 2 years. Let's give me a little bit of a time to run things. But a year into office, you'll be saying, wow, I remember that interview. He said he was going to do it, and he did a great job.
Ladies and gentlemen, the president of the Savage States of America.
We the people did it. That's right. We the people did it. I love the articles that it's all the uneducated, dumb American white males out there who did it. They couldn't be further from the truth. I know so many people with highest degrees you could imagine who are 100% in Trump's camp. But these idiots are so out of touch with reality that they continue to feed each other the same lie that they're smarter than everyone, they're brighter than everyone, they're better educated than everyone, and only the dumb, unwashed masses out there elected Donald Trump. Nothing can be further from the truth. We won everything. We won the presidency. We won the House. We won the Senate. We won 26 governorships. But the biggest prize of all, next to the presidency, is that we won the Supreme Court for the next 50 years. Let me tell you something. God's hand is all over this election, and I'm going to prove it to you today. I've been getting emails from Israel proving that the Jewish Torah, in the letters of the Torah, predicted Trump's victory, and we're going to talk about that as well. But I've got to go back to the beginning. Were it not for you, the listener of the Savage Nation, there would be no Donald Trump. Make no mistake about it. We were there for him long before anyone else. All those who ridiculed him, criticized him, ridiculed you, calling you Trumpsters, Trumpettes, Trump voters, Trump of this, or Trump of that. They laughed at you. Then they joined the parade all of a sudden. That's great. I'm glad everyone joined the parade. But long before they were there, I was there. And I bet on him and I won. I won big time. And the important part is that America won big time. It's not about Michael Savage. It's about America. It's not even about Donald Trump. He is a vehicle of change in this country and in the world. One of the first leaders to have contacted Donald Trump is the president of Egypt, because he knows that had the she-witch won, the Muslim Brotherhood would have been activated in Egypt, bringing down the largest Muslim nation on earth. 80 million people live in Egypt, and she wanted the Muslim Brotherhood to run Egypt. Never forget who she is. Never forget who Mook is. Never forget who Podesta is. Never forget who they all are, and they are part of the basket of history right now. They are in the dumpster of history, all of them, thank God. But now what do we do? How do we pick up the pieces? That's the topic of today's show and tomorrow's show and the next show. I received an email. First, I got to make this personal in order to make it political. I went to sleep after my party last night around 12 or 1 in the morning. It was before her concession speech. I really couldn't take much more of it. And before I went to sleep, I watched that guy, whatever his name is, Podesta, give the speech. I saw a face unlike any I had seen in modern American history. When he actually got on the stage, I saw the face of a touch of evil. Let me put it to you that way. It was a face of evil. And he would not concede last night. And I sent some friends emails, and I said, I'm afraid they're going to steal it in the middle of the night because he would not concede the election. I said to them, I'm afraid they're going to steal the election. In fact, I had Doug Lynn up in Oregon put it up on my Facebook and Twitter feed saying, I'm afraid they're going to steal it in the middle of the night. Well, just as I turned the lights out and was about to go to sleep, there it came. She gave the concession speech. Four major newspapers declared him the winner. I had to take down my Facebook posting. So they gave it up pretty quickly, and I didn't think that they would. But you know, Hillary knew she would lose a few days ago. Why do I say that? The media's acting shocked. But she canceled her fireworks show for New York City 2 or 3 days ago. Internal polling showed them she was not going to win. Internal polling showed her what we all knew, that Obama is the most hated president in the history of this nation, the most divisive, hated man to have ever stolen the presidency. And by the way, we have 90 more days of this devil in the White House. He will use every trick in the book, executive orders. You can't believe what he's going to do to this country before he walks out of there. So we have a big fight on our hands, don't we? We have to keep our eyes on the ball. I know many of you want to celebrate, and you should. We have the presidency, the House of Representatives, the U.S. Senate, and we're going to have the Supreme Court. And speaking of the Supreme Court, Donald Trump gets to replace the Supreme Court justice who died under mysterious circumstances. I believe he was executed. I believe the Supreme Court justice was killed, smothered to death. And the reason I say it is, it's logical, it's common sense. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on it. But you know, even if a homeless bum is found dead in the streets somewhere in America, the law requires that the homeless bum be subjected to an autopsy. Do you know that there was no autopsy of the highest Supreme Court justice in the land after he was found smothered to death in Texas in a border hotel? No autopsy. They cremated him right away. It was a cover-up. They killed him. And they killed him so they can push their psychotic socialist agenda forward. That was my opinion. It still is. Well, anyway, that's history. Trump replaces the Chief Justice of Supreme Court. Then we got the psychosis of Breyer, the psychosis of that maniac from the ACLU. She's going. They're in their 80s. They're on their last legs. They will be gone during his term. And he will replace them, I hope, with young men and women for the Supreme Court no older than 35 years of age. Because I want a conservative Supreme Court for the next 50 years. That's what we're going to have. And God's hand is all over this. Many of you had the faith that we could win. I had calls yesterday, and one sticks in my mind of all of them. It was from a man alone in a truck somewhere in Ohio. I don't remember where he was calling from, or Pennsylvania. And he said, Michael, I'm one of the Eddies out there. I'm one of the deplorables. He said, I'm sitting alone in a truck looking at a cornfield. I'm the one that was forgotten. I'm the one that was laughed at. I'm the one that was spit at by Hillary and those in the media. He said, I don't know what to think right now. But he said, after Donald was on your show, he said, I have hope. If you missed that interview, you missed something very special. And if you think that Donald Trump appearing on the Savage Nation yesterday was not instrumental in him winning yesterday in so many marginal districts. I mean marginal not in terms of individuals, but in terms of the competition. You are mistaken. There was a reason that his handlers chose the Savage Nation for the 12th hour. And that is because this audience is the most activist audience in American media. Never make a mistake about that one. You are the most activist audience of any audience in the United States of America. There are shows with larger numbers of listeners, but they're nowhere near as active. They're nowhere near as passionate about the show as you are. And I can prove it to you with the fact that I ran a last-ditch campaign to win the National Radio Hall of Fame Award, and I ran against a very strong competitor who has far more stations than I with his own TV show, and I beat him by a large margin because you voted me in. It was directly to the people. That was almost a harbinger of what was coming. You see, when awards are picked by people on the inside, they can pick anyone they want. Just like the media picked Hillary Clinton. They said she was going to win. They sneered at Trump. But when the people themselves are allowed to voice their decisions, something else entirely happens. And that's what just happened. We saw our republic in action. We saw what the vote actually can mean. Many of you had given up on the process. I have a young man, 27 years old, who works for me as my personal assistant and as a producer and many other things. And he said he has hope for America now. He said, I actually thought the system was rigged and that no honest man could ever win an election again in this country. He said, I have hope for the future. I have hope for America. But the first thoughts I had last night after coming home from that fabulous dinner that I put on over at a certain place in San Francisco with some of the finest people I ever met in my life, all I could think about was how police felt this morning and how soldiers felt this morning and how Marines felt this morning and how pilots felt this morning. All I could think was that the cops felt steel running through their veins again. And all I could think is that the soldiers felt hope again. And they felt steel running through their spines again, dying to pick up arms for America, Americans, and our freedom. Once again, they feel the pride of their duty to America, and they're not going to have to face the wrath of the most hateful president America has ever had to live through. A man who has turned the war on police into an art form, getting away with virtual murder while pretending that he's a man of peace. They're not going to have to put up with this come January, are they? Because one thing is for sure, Donald Trump is going to be on the side of law and order. And even liberals want law and order. They are tired of being knocked down in the streets of New York by thugs who have been activated by Barack Obama. They are tired of being pushed in front of subway cars in New York subways because they've been activated by Barack Obama, who's given them a wink and a nod telling them about inequality and white privilege. They're sick of it. So I'm going to try and play a piece of the Trump interview from yesterday, if you missed it. I want to read you one line from my war hero friend. He will remain anonymous. Silver Star Vietnam paratrooper. His father was in the First World War, World War II, behind German lines, disguised as a German officer to capture Mussolini. One of the finest men I ever met in my life. He sent me an email in the middle of the night. He said, Michael, you stood in there like a rock. Good on you. What a night. Well done. He said, who would have thought we commoners would have the audacity? In both cases, votes for freedom and sovereignty from the globalists and leftist oligarchs. Thank you very much. Of course, I got so much more I want to talk about. I may as well throw it out right now. I was getting emails from religious people about a week ago telling me that it was predicted by a leading biblical figure in Israel that Trump was going to win, that there were mentions in the Jewish Torah that Trump would win. I didn't pay much attention to it because I don't believe that much in that stuff, to be honest with you. But I look at it and I said, holy God. Source, breaking news, Israel. Trump upset victory divinely sent to begin messianic process, say the rabbis. And they say, as the rabbi who oversees the final resting place of King David on Mount Zion, Rabbi Yosef Berger is intimately connected to the spirituality of kingship. For him, it was clear what tipped the scales in favor of the Republican underdog. Listen to this. He said, I have known for months that Donald Trump would win the elections, Rabbi Berger told the Breaking Israel News. The numerology of his name is Moshiach, which means Messiah. He is connected to the messianic process, which is happening right now. When Trump promised to move the American embassy to Jerusalem, he attached himself to the power of the Messiah, which gave him the boost he needed. If you separate from Jerusalem, disaster will follow. And then they go on with another quotation from another ancient Jewish biblical source, from a source called the Gematria. And I'm not going to read it to you because most of you don't want to hear the details. But the fact of the matter is they believe God's hand was involved in this election. Who can deny that? I want you to listen to the tone of this interview. If you have a few minutes, this was Donald Trump yesterday, just before the vote on the Savage Nation. Donald, thank you so much for being with us today, this election day. What is going on? Do you have any initial results out there?
Well, we're just hearing very good things, Michael. I think it's going to be an amazing evening.
Donald, you know, we're getting calls on the show today in this first hour with people. I asked them what they would like to say to you. And overwhelmingly, they're saying, win, lose, or draw, you've already done the country a great service. You have changed the national conversation, Donald. You know that, don't you?
Well, I really appreciate it. I've had thank yous from so many people. You know, it's a vicious business. I used to think real estate was vicious. real estate people are like soft people compared to these, people I've been dealing with for the last year and a half.
I can just imagine. So after this election, first of all, Donald, I want to thank you personally for showing your loyalty to me personally. I know that you're not doing a lot of national radio shows today. I know you wanted to come on to the Savage Nation because in many ways we had you on before anyone else did on a regular basis. And I know your loyalty is very important to you. I told the people that you're the most loyal politician I've ever encountered in this business. So again, I want to thank you for that, period.
Well, thank you, Michael, and you've been loyal also. And I did want to do your show, and I have done very, very little today because, you know, I'm sort of sitting back and seeing what happens. I've gone through a marathon of speeches in front of these massive crowds.
Donald, what is the greatest lesson you have learned from this horrible campaign?
Well, I think I've learned two things. Tremendous people that we have in this country. Tremendous people with tremendous potential. And, you know, people that are really, you know, if you would have told me, I've gone through all corners of the country, and we just have people that are absolutely incredible people. Also, likewise, incredible dishonesty, total dishonesty.
Amazing 12th hour appearance before you. I want to say this. After that interview, people said to me, Trump sounded defeated. It sounded as though he was admitting he lost. I said, no, you don't understand it. He didn't sound defeated at all. He sounded resigned to me, not defeated. He was resigned to his fate. And what you heard between Michael and Donald yesterday were two men who were saying to each other, as you listen, you'll see it or hear it, we did the best we could. We fought the best battle we could have fought. And we did the best. And, you know, we can't control the outcome. We don't know what's going to happen. We sat down as though we were together after a war. And we were waiting for the outcome of the war. We didn't quite know what it was. That's what you heard. You didn't hear defeat. You heard resignation and acceptance.
The unified opposition of the political elite, the establishment news media, billionaires, the political left, Wall Street barons, banksters, European Union politicians and bureaucrats, and even the United Nations convinced me early in the campaign season that God's hand was upon Donald J. Trump for a very special mission. Susan and I had an amazing conversation last March with Dr. Don Colbert and his wife, Mary. They shared with us a written copy of a prophecy given to one of Dr. Colbert's patients on April 28, 2011. That prophecy said that God had chosen Donald Trump to become the president of the United States, and no opposition would succeed in stopping him. The man's name is Mark Taylor, a retired firefighter here in the state of Florida. I invited Mark back on to True News to talk about this amazing accomplishment. His first interview last April quickly went viral and was heard by millions of people and played an important role in convincing Christians in America to support and vote for Donald Trump. I thought it would be appropriate to invite Mark back today as we savor the victory of the Trump movement and as we give thanksgiving to God for answering our prayers and fastings. Mark, welcome back to True News.
Rick, thank you for having me. It's an honor and a pleasure to be here today.
Yes, sir. For the benefit of the people who don't know about your prophecy and that interview, Mark, it It went viral beyond anything we have ever seen. Millions of people heard that interview. For the benefit of the people who don't know about it, give us a brief recap of what the Lord told you in April 2011.
Well, they can go to my website and download it as well, but it was called Commander in Chief, and it was back in 2011. The Lord had showed me that Donald Trump was anointed for America to be the next president. And it said basically that the enemy was going to shake and quake when he announces that he's running for president, that the Lord was tired of the enemy stealing from America, and America was going to reap a harvest that was going to be plundered from the enemy and return it back to the United States sevenfold. And then that America will once again stand hand in hand with Israel, and America will be protected as Israel, and the ties between Israel and America will be stronger than like they've never been before. This president would be a man of his word, that anytime that he speaks, the world would listen. The mainstream news media would be captivated by this man, and eventually they will end up agreeing with this man.
You know, Mark, it's amazing that throughout the campaign, Donald Trump told the American people that other nations were stealing from America.
Yes. Yeah, they've been stealing from America for decades. And, you know, unfortunately, we've got people in government that have been allowing this. And, you know, Trump's been around a long time. He knows the business aspect of things. He knows how things work. So he's been seeing this for a long time. And, you know, the global elites are trying to protect that. And this is exactly what we've been asking God to do, was to take this down. And we saw that last night. I mean, God has performed everything he said he was going to do. And, you know, first and foremost, I want to give credit to the Lord Jesus, who is the spirit of prophecy, because this is not about me. This is not about one person. This was a team effort by the church, you know, whether it was prophesying, whether it was praying, interceding, and fasting, you know, that they rose to the occasion, and God did exactly what he said he was going to do, and it was a massive victory for the body of Christ last night. But I do want to put out this one thing, is that, you know, we've won the battle, but we haven't quite won the war. And I want to put this out there, and I'm not trying to be doom and gloom, is that this is not a time for the army of God to lay down your weapons, because we've accomplished the first objective, which was getting him elected. The next objective is going to be getting him sworn in. And I do believe that the enemy may try a couple of things to try and stop that. It will not be successful, but it will be up to the church to continue to pray, war, and fight until we get this man actually sworn in.
I agree. And even after he is inaugurated on January 20th, the battle continues, because we have to implement the agenda.
Yes.
And there will be intense spiritual opposition to cleaning up this country